The story of the Battle of Balaclava is filled with acts of heroic courage, including the victory against the odds of Sir Colin Campbell's thin red line, and the dashing charge of the Heavy Brigade, led by the remarkable Sir James Scarlett. But it is the men of the Light Brigade and their valiant, doomed charge who are now part of British military folklore. The exact reasons for the war in the Crimea were deep-rooted, but lay principally in the British government's fear of Russian expansionism. Russia had long harbored designs on the Balkans in southeastern Europe, and her ambitious Tsar, Nicholas I, saw the crumbling of the Turkish Empire as the perfect opportunity to further press his claims. The capture of Constantinople would give Russia complete control over the entrance to the Black Sea from the Mediterranean, through the Dardanelles and the Bosphorus. With an already secure and established naval base at Sevastopol, this would open the way for Russia's warships to dominate the Mediterranean and afford her massive influence over foreign trade routes, particularly those of Britain and France.
Britain joined the Crimean War to defend her ally, Turkey, to maintain the balance of power in Europe, and to protect her extensive commercial interests in the Middle East.
In the mid-19th century, Turkey was known as the sick man of Europe, so other great powers, Britain and France, wanted to make sure that Russia did not secure a huge victory and upset the strategic balance.
On the 30th of November 1853, the Russians attacked the Turkish fleet at anchor in the harbour of Sinope, near Constantinople, and destroyed it completely, with a loss of 4,000 Turkish lives. The British reacted to the news with outrage, and in an instant, the press was demanding action. They pilloried the Prime Minister, Lord Aberdeen. Unable to resist the enormous wave of public feeling, the British government delivered an ultimatum to Russia on the 27th of February 1854. Russian troops must withdraw from Moldavia and Wallachia by the 30th of April, or Britain and France would be at war with Russia. This stipulation for peace was contemptuously ignored by Tsar Nicholas. So Britain set about building an army to defeat the Russians. Obviously, a full-scale war with a nation as vast as Russia was out of the question. And the War of 1854 was always seen as a short, sharp lesson to be handed out to the upstart Russians. Britain and France chose to concentrate on two fronts: a naval war in the Baltic, and in the areas where the main threat to their interests lay, the Crimea and the Russian bases at Sevastopol. Overall command of the British Expeditionary Force was given to Lord Raglan, the 66-year-old Master of the Ordnance.
Raglan was appointed to his command because he'd had experience under Wellington. Wellington was the main military commander of the early 19th century for the British, and it's on his reputation that the British Army rested. Raglan had served with him. Raglan had been with him for 8 years. And so he was appointed because he knew how to fight battles in accordance with Wellington.
In all that time, in all the military jobs he'd had, not a single one was a command. He had never commanded troops in the field. And he'd been promoted time and time again on seniority.
Having said that, of course, he was chosen because he was a man of considerable diplomatic tact, and this was, after all, a coalition war. He had to deal with allies, and on the whole, he dealt with his allies pretty efficiently.
Raglan was given 5 infantry divisions, numbering 26,000 men. Of these five divisions, only one of the commanders who led them was under 60 years of age. The addition of two cavalry brigades brought the total army strength to 28,000. It was these same cavalry who had earned the campaign its place in history, and it was among their ranks that the most interesting characters were to be found. Their overall commander was Lord Lucan, a hard-bitten, experienced cavalryman of 54 years. He had no say in the choice of his two subordinates, and was mortified to learn that command of the Light Brigade had been entrusted to his brother-in-law, Lord Cardigan. The two men loathed each other and made no attempt to conceal it. Command of the other cavalry formation, the Heavy Brigade, was less controversial. It was led by Brigadier General James Scarlett, a 55-year-old, and a man who was to fight with great distinction during the campaign. From February 1854, troops left Britain for the Crimean Peninsula amid scenes of wild enthusiasm from an excited public, eager to send off Her Majesty's army with a rousing cheer. But in August came news which should have signalled the end of the campaign before it started. Russia, alarmed at the massing of troops by Austria on its eastern frontier, withdrew from Moldavia and Wallachia, thereby complying with the terms of the British ultimatum.
The 4 points that had been at the heart of the dispute had been met. And effectively what happens is the British government adds in a fifth point, which is the issue of breaking Russian sea power in the Black Sea and the Eastern Mediterranean.
So, when the Russians, at the last minute, decide that they can do without the Turkish provinces of Vlachia and Moldavia, and pull out of the Balkan principalities, it doesn't matter anymore. The war is going to happen. The goal had become Sevastopol.
Fortified by continued public support, the government instructed Raglan to attack Sevastopol and destroy the Russian fleet. The likelihood of achieving these ambitious orders was not aided by the fact that no invasion plan actually existed. Furthermore, little or nothing was known of the Russian strength, and even less had been learned about the terrain over which the Allied armies were about to do battle. The Allies, 27,000 British, 30,000 French, and 7,000 Turks, landed unopposed at Kalamata Bay in the Crimea on the 14th of September, 1854. It was full 5 days before the disembarkation was complete, and the Allied army could begin its march south towards Sevastopol, which lay 35 miles away. If Raglan had been surprised that the Kalamata Bay landings had met no opposition, he was soon to see the reason why. Ranged along the south bank of the River Alma was the forbidding site of the waiting Russian army. Comprising 33,000 infantry and 3,400 cavalry, with 28 guns set in redoubts, it was commanded by His Highness Prince Alexander Menshikov, who had given the Tsar his personal assurance that the Allied advance would be checked and the line at Alma held for at least 3 weeks, allowing time for the strengthening of the defences at Sevastopol. For the first time, the two great armies had sight of their enemy. The Battle of the Alma began with a French attack commanded by General Canrobert, which, although wildly enthusiastic, achieved little. However, the British Light and First Divisions began to make steady progress, with the Coldstream and Grenadier Guards advancing in splendid order up the slope, shattering the Russian lines with their volleys of fire. To the west, the French overthrew the Russian left flank, and victory was assured when the Highland Brigade, brilliantly commanded by Sir Colin Campbell, completed the rout of the enemy right. The spectacular Allied triumph had taken only 1.5 hours, and the Russians were in full retreat towards Sevastopol.
The Battle of the Alma was a very confused encounter, largely due to the mistakes made by the commanders on both sides. It was won by the officers actually in the battle line, men like Sir Colin Campbell and the Highland Brigade, leading their troops with initiative, and also by the determination of the British troops, especially with their never-say-die attitude.
While the British took heart and rested, few could have known it, but there now came the turning point in the whole campaign. Lord Lucan, whose cavalry had not seen action at Alma, vigorously urged Raglan to send them in pursuit of the fleeing Russians, but Raglan refused. Lucan had seen that there was a golden opportunity to storm Sevastopol from the north, whilst the Russians were confused and unprepared.
If they attacked the northern part, they were faced by an important star fort, a very important, strong fortification, and two small redoubts that had recently been built by the Russians on the Belbek River. Now, the French were reluctant to attack against the star fort, so there's a reluctance from the French to attack the northern part of Sevastopol.
The object of the Allied attack on Sevastopol was to destroy the port city and sink the Russian fleet. Had the Allies captured the Star Fort and the cliffs to the north of Sevastopol harbour, they could have destroyed both the fleet and the city and withdrawn well before the winter.
Instead, with the French in complete agreement, Raglan opted to circumnavigate Sevastopol and attack from the south. In so doing, he spurned a gilt-edged chance and opened the way for the grueling months of war which were soon to follow.
It's important to remember, of course, that as far as the Allies are concerned, they don't know where Menshikov's army has gone after the Battle of the Alma. It's still in the field. It's not gone rushing into Sevastopol. They're in unknown country. They're not sure of their lines of communication. They haven't got very good maps. There are all sorts of reasons for being cautious. But with the wisdom of hindsight, it was a great opportunity missed.
The Russian garrison of Sevastopol, commanded by Admiral Komilov, seized upon its good fortune and set about strengthening its defences, while Menshikov withdrew his army to the interior. The main priority for the British and French was to secure their lines of supply, which reached them by sea. So the Army of the East passed around Sevastopol towards the Chersonese plateau, its objective, the two harbours, Kamyesh and Balaclava. If the troops were to be supplied from England and France, it was essential that they should quickly capture a safe deep water harbour. Balaclava was chosen as the target, and the harbour was secured by the British on September the 26th, after only token resistance from its defenders. With the port secure, the infantry moved onto the Chersonese uplands, to the south of Sevastopol, leaving the two cavalry divisions defending Balaclava. Crucially, it was decided not to attack Sevastopol immediately. Count Robert and the French High Command insisted on a full artillery bombardment of the town before an attempt could be made, and Raglan, ever mindful of the need to maintain the strength of the Anglo-French alliance, once again concurred. But it took 8 days of backbreaking work to prepare the artillery batteries, time in which the Russian defences grew stronger as Allied morale weakened.
The British and French allies were getting all of their supplies at that point by a long, bad road from a port that was really ridden with disease. And they had to move everything up by road, but they had had this entire campaign a serious shortage of pack horses, draft horses, and mules. And as a result, they were unable to get the supplies up these bad roads from the disease-ridden port well enough to properly supply their troops.
The conditions before Sevastopol were very hard on the men in the siege lines. I mean, first of all, few of them had tents, and then there was the threat of cholera from bad water. And also, their diet was mostly salt meat, which is not actually a very healthy thing to be depending on.
With the siege works completed, the artillery began its bombardment on the 17th of October. But despite a week of shelling which wrought death and havoc to Sevastopol, the Russian garrison would not yield. To add to the Allied problems, a new danger appeared. Intelligence reported that Menshikov's 25,000 Russian troops were massing in preparation for an attack on Balaclava. Unconvinced, Raglan was skeptical of the reports and made the fateful decision to disregard them totally.
Raglan was skeptical when he first heard of the Russian attack because he'd heard this too many times before. There'd been a series of false alarms, and he knew that it was in the best interest of the Russians to distract his attention from conducting the siege attack. And every time he moved his infantry out of the trenches, he held back the progress of his attack on Sevastopol itself. Consequently, he was unwilling to move until he saw clearly that the Russians were committed.
He doesn't trust the reports he's getting, but he isn't compensating for it by putting out spies or by putting out cavalry to reconnoiter.
The man responsible for the defense of the vital port at Balaclava was Sir Colin Campbell. To secure its defense, a line of six redoubts had been constructed along the causeway heights to the north of the port, about 800 yards apart, and manned mostly by Turkish troops. 1,200 Royal Marines with 26 guns were placed on the eastern side of the Balaclava Gorge, and at the entrance to the gorge were ranged the 93rd Highlanders, W Battery Royal Artillery, and a battalion of Turks. The nearest cavalry was half a mile to the south, under the command of Lord Lucan.
With the troops available, they were reasonably well organized, because the main task was to pursue the siege of Sevastopol. We only had limited forces. So Raglan, who was responsible for the defense of the eastern side of the Allied line and for Balaclava, bearing in mind his priorities, had arranged the defences fairly well.
But the other troops which were needed to defend Balaclava were simply kept too far back, and so as the battle unfolded, it took a long time to get the British infantry especially into line.
The Russians had done their homework well. They realised that the nearest infantry reinforcements available to Campbell were on the Chersonese plateau, perhaps 2 hours away. Menshikov planned a massive attack on the redoubts from the west, sending a total of 25 battalions and 78 guns to seize the position. Three more columns were to assault from the east, whilst further infantry and cavalry lay in reserve to the north, in the North Valley and Fediukine Hills. Although Raglan remained unconvinced of a potential attack on the redoubts, Lucan, in command of the cavalry, was much more concerned.
The Allies had six redoubts at Balaclava, six little fortresses. Each one had British 12-pounder naval guns, manned by Turkish gunners. And the Turkish gunners were considered, in the racial theory of the time, to be reliable purely because they were ethnically Turkish, and people thought that ethnic Turks make good soldiers. And there was little attention given to the fact that they were poorly led, they were very exposed in these little fortresses, and they had not got a lot of motivation to stay where they were and fight their guns against the Russians from these exposed positions.
The first Russian shells hit No. 1 Redoubt on the 25th of October. With surprise on their side, the Russians quickly overran the redoubts. And by 7:30 a.m., the situation had become hopeless. The Russians now controlled all of the redoubts along the Causeway Heights. It was then that Raglan appeared on the scene, and after surveying the battlefield from the eastern escarpment, sent orders to the 1st and 4th Divisions of Infantry to march in support of Sir Colin Campbell. He also ordered Lucan with his cavalry to withdraw to the south of the last redoubt, where they could be protected by artillery fire from the surrounding hills. Lucan was less than pleased to receive Raglan's instruction. It left the 93rd Highlanders, only 550 strong, positioned on a small ridge north of Kadikioy, between the Russians and the entrance to the Balaclava Gorge. Sir Colin Campbell, alert to the danger of the situation, managed to augment his meagre troops with 40 sick or wounded guardsmen, plus a few Turks from the redoubts and the artillery of W Battery. But before long, the Russian guns from the captured redoubts began to find their range, so Campbell ordered the 93rd to form up on the reverse slope of the ridge. Four eager squadrons of Lieutenant General Rzhov's Russian cavalry soon charged along the North Valley between captured redoubts 4 and 5, directly towards Campbell's 93rd. Campbell formed his men into two ranks, still on the reverse side of the slope. And as the Russian cavalry thundered towards them, he had his two lines of men make a sudden dramatic appearance at the crest of the ridge.
The 93rd were on what's called a reverse slope. That meant that as you looked at the hill where they were, you couldn't see them because they were just the other side of the hill.
And what this meant was that as the Russian cavalry advanced across the plain towards him, his men were suddenly able to reach the crest and unleash volleys into the cavalry, surprising them and confusing them. I mean, technically, Sir Colin Campbell should have formed his men into square, which would have done two things. It would have protected their flanks and also prevented them from being ridden down by the cavalry. But such was their determination, the thin red line as it's recorded, and the efficiency of their musketry, that the cavalry was simply scared away.
If you deploy into square, three out of four sides of the square cannot engage to their front. By deploying into line, every single rifle could be used.
Lord Raglan watched the superb performance of Campbell's 93rd from his position above the battlefield. Expecting them to be overrun, he had ordered Lucan to send cavalry support to Campbell. Lucan therefore ordered Sir James Scarlett to detach eight squadrons from his heavy brigade and ride towards Kadikioy. In doing so, he paved the way for another of the morning's glorious actions. Scarlett, as ordered, moved off from the foot of the Sapune Ridge towards Kadikioy with his eight squadrons. Their advance took them to the south of the hastily struck Light Brigade camp, which had been vacated only a few hours earlier, and then past a large vineyard. It was here that Scarlett first saw what must have been an unexpected sight. The remainder of Rzhov's cavalry, all 2,000 strong, who had left the North Valley and were heading directly towards them. As with the four squadrons of hussars who had attacked the thin red line, confusion appeared to beset the Russian charge at the crucial moment, and Inexplicably, Rzhov halted his 2,000 cavalry only 100 yards from Scarlet. It gave Scarlet the breathing space he needed and afforded him the completely unexpected opportunity to engage a stationary, if numerically superior, enemy. This was to be the famous charge of the Heavy Brigade.
The Russians didn't have a clear plan. They stopped on the height above where Scarlet was, and they didn't therefore know exactly what to do. They were therefore static, and that's important. You'd never receive a cavalry charge in a static position. And without orders from their officers and without a clear plan, they basically stood and waited. From their point of view, therefore, it was indecision. From Scarlet's point of view, it was bravery and clear decision. He charged uphill with a small number of troops, and the very fact that he did so against a cavalry which was numerically superior but static was the crucial factor.
Scarlet, Lieutenant Elliot and the trumpeter, and Scarlet's huge orderly Shagog were first to the Russians, at least 50 or 60 yards ahead of the Inniskillings and the Scots Greys. The remarkable Brigadier General was soon deep inside the Russian ranks, thrusting and slicing with his sword. Within seconds, the brass-hatted Inniskillings and the bare-skinned Scots Greys joined in the frantic fight for life. Incredibly, only 10 minutes after Scarlet had crashed into the Russian ranks, the five squadrons of British cavalry, just 500 strong, had gained the ascendancy over the 2,000 Russians, and their formation began to crumble. A final assault on their right flank by the 4th Dragoon Guards was decisive. The Russians began a disorderly retreat towards the Causeway Heights.
The charge of the Heavy Brigade worked, although it was never a charge, because Scarlet's troopers were mounted on very big horses and they were very big men. They moved uphill at a steady trot and simply barged the Russians out of the way. The Russian cavalry they charged into were mostly Cossacks and light hussars. It was rather like the Household Brigade riding down a pony club gymkhana.
So the British had won a tremendous second victory in the developing Battle of Balaclava. Spirits were high, and the Russians were in some disarray. However, less than 2 hours from now, disaster would befall the unfortunate Light Brigade. Rzhov withdrew his confused and battered cavalry to the relative safety of the North Valley's eastern end, where they joined the 8 guns of the 3rd Don Cossack Field Battery. In close proximity were a further 22 Russian guns, making a formidable 30 pieces of artillery ranged on 3 sides of the valley. It was to be 90 long minutes before the first British moves were made to engage them.
After the Russians were broken up by the Heavy Brigade and by the Heavy Brigade's artillery support, nobody stopped them as they moved off down the valley and reformed. The Light Brigade, for instance, allowed them to just walk away, and the Russians were able to move off down the valley, reform their cavalry, and sight their guns to protect the cavalry's flanks and sight their guns up in front of the cavalry. So the Russians were able to form up a very strong defensive position because nobody bothered to chase after them.
Raglan was desperate to take advantage of the Heavy Brigade's victory, but he was frustrated in his plans by the painfully slow progress of the infantry divisions, originally ordered onto the plain to support the 93rd Highlanders. Raglan had intended the infantry to join with the cavalry and recapture the redoubts still occupied by the Russians. But he eventually lost patience, and at 10:15 a.m., sent the order to Lucan, "Cavalry to advance and take advantage of any opportunity to recover the heights. They will be supported by the infantry, which has been ordered to advance on two fronts." It was now that confusion and uncertainty began to take a grip on the proceedings. Lucan formed up the light and heavy brigades at the west end of the North Valley, between the Ferryukeen Hills and the Causeway Heights. He now expected to be ordered against the Russians, who had been previously defeated by the heavy brigade. But with the additional guns, the Russians were now in well-prepared positions which could not be attacked without infantry support. What Lucan could not see, however, owing to the undulation of the terrain, was Russian artillerymen attempting to carry away guns from the redoubts on the Causeway Heights. And it was against these men that Raglan expected Lucan to attack. While Raglan, from his position, could clearly observe the situation, Lucan was completely unaware of the fate of the guns and stayed still while he awaited the arrival of the infantry he needed to move against his objective. Raglan became increasingly annoyed with Lucan. The tragedy of the Light Brigade was about to be played out.
Lucan did not react to the order which he received at 10:15 from an ADC, sent from Raglan, which intended him to attack the heights and stop the Russians taking away guns which they captured from the redoubts that morning. It wasn't until he got the next order, which is the final order, which is carried down by Captain Edward Nolan, at approximately 10:40, that he reacted and began to organise what later becomes the charge of the Light Brigade.
Raglan called forward the noted horseman, Captain Edward Nolan, a man with an uneven temper and excitable nature, and issued him with his second order to be delivered to Lucan. "Lord Raglan wishes the cavalry to advance rapidly to the front and try to prevent the enemy carrying away the guns. Troops of horse artillery may accompany. French cavalry is on your left." It was Raglan's unfortunate decision to entrust Nolan with the order, which directly led to the disaster which was to follow. Lucan, who could not see the guns being carried away, received the order with a mixture of bewilderment and deep concern, as to all intents and purposes, he was being ordered to charge formed artillery head-on, a suicidal mission. Lucan insisted Nolan return to clarify the command. Nolan replied, "Lord Raglan's orders are that the cavalry should attack immediately." To which Lucan snapped, "Attack, sir? Attack what? What guns, sir?" Lucan, of course, was justified in his uncertainty. He had not seen and could not see the guns in the redoubts on the Causeway Heights. But by now, Nolan was in a state of high excitement, and with mounting insubordination, he thrust his arm out in the direction of the guns awaiting in excellent position at the end of the North Valley. The wrong valley. "There, my lord, is your enemy. There are your guns."
It's possible that the personality of Nolan was important because he wasn't able rationally to explain to Lucan exactly what the order meant. It was the practice of ADCs who carried messages to be able to explain and answer questions. They weren't there to change the order, they were there to explain it. But in this case, there is a question mark as to whether the clash between essentially an overbearing lieutenant general and a rather impertinent captain did not stop that process being carried out as it should have been.
Although Nolan has been blamed in part for the mistake of the charge of the Light Brigade, I think this is really unfair. He was a very experienced cavalryman. He was a military theoretician who'd written a book on the tactical use of cavalry. And it may be that he actually tried to change the order, redirect the movement once he saw where the Light Brigade was going.
Lucan, possibly flustered by the confusion and Nolan's highly insubordinate manner, made the fatal decision to attack the guns at the end of the North Valley. The 3rd Don's Cossack Battery, and not the guns being carried off from the redoubts on the Causeway Heights. He rode over to his hated brother-in-law, Lord Cardigan, and informed him of his decision. Cardigan tersely pointed out that a battery of guns on 3 sides awaited them, to which Lucan replied, "I know it, but Lord Raglan will have it, and we have no choice but to obey."
Lord Lucan hated the Earl of Cardigan. Lord Cardigan hated Lord Lucan. Lew Nolan hated the Earl of Cardigan and Lord Lucan. And Lord Raglan couldn't get a grip on any of them. And the result was that nobody wanted to take orders from anybody else. Nobody wanted to help anybody else. And everybody just sank into this morass of hatred and bloody-mindedness in which nobody would do what they were supposed to do.
There can be little doubt that the lack of mutual respect between the British commanders had a substantial influence on the disaster of the charge of the Light Brigade, especially the real personal animosity between Lucan and Cardigan meant that they couldn't really speak to one another. They just simply wouldn't communicate effectively.
There was, therefore, no attempt to rectify the order. Cardigan, with the words, "The brigade will advance," gave his order. And the 3 lines of the Light Brigade began to ride slowly down the valley. Behind them were Lucan and Scarlet with the Heavy Brigade. Despite Lucan's exhortation to maintain a walk, the 600 men of the Light Brigade soon began to trot, leaving the heavy some way behind. It was then that a famous and dramatic scene occurred. Captain Nolan, who had sought and been granted permission to ride with the 17th Lancers in the Light Brigade, suddenly galloped forward ahead of Cardigan, yelling frantically and waving his saber. Had he at last realized that Cardigan and his cavalry were about to attack the wrong guns? Was Nolan's extraordinary behavior a desperate attempt to redirect the charge away from the waiting Cossack battery and towards the redoubts on the Causeway Heights? History will never know, for as Nolan surged forward, he was shot through the chest, therefore becoming the first fatality of the charge. Soon, the Light Brigade were thundering along the valley, and the awful slaughter began. Behind the smoke and dust of the Light Brigade, Lord Lucan and the heavies were struggling to keep up. Before long, a dangerous gap had opened up between the 2 brigades, and Lucan was faced with an agonizing decision. Should he press on and try to join the Light Brigade, which he could see being cut to ribbons before him? Or should he halt, cut his losses, and cover their inevitable retreat down the North Valley? Lucan could see little point in continuing, and so ordered the Heavy Brigade to halt. Meanwhile, the Light Brigade, with Lord Cardigan at its head, continued to display the dauntless courage and discipline which were to characterize every Victorian army.
In the Light Brigade action, the Russian cannon would have started firing at a range around 1,000 yards using single solid shot, which would have skipped along the ground and knocked out of their way anything they ran into. At somewhere under 300 yards, they'd have switched over to grape shot, firing 1 or 2 pound balls in a tightly packaged shotgun-like round. And if they got a chance to fire under 50 yards, they might have switched to canister shot, which is musket ball sized, multiple round.
From the time that the light brigade came within range of the Russian guns, they were constantly being killed, man after man and horse after horse, by a storm of grapeshot. They kept on being hit by these goose egg sized balls the closer they came to the Russian guns, over and over again until they could actually ride past the guns.
The first line was only 100 yards from the Russian guns when they loosed off a final dreadful volley of grapeshot, which ripped the line asunder, leaving only 150 men remaining on horseback. Incredibly, Lord Cardigan was among them, and he rode almost contemptuously between the guns before coming face to face with the Russian cavalry waiting behind the artillery. Cardigan, his objective reached, his duty done, wheeled his horse around and cantered back up the valley. No sooner had the Light Brigade's fortunate survivors arrived at the guns than they were faced with a further desperate battle for life as the waiting Russian Cossacks fell upon them, yelling wildly. Bravely, the Light Brigade fought on, sabering the gunners. A series of bitter hand-to-hand fights ensued. The shattered remains of the Light Brigade returned in battered and bleeding groups down the North Valley. Lord Cardigan, ever the military man, sought out Lucan to complain bitterly about the behaviour of Captain Nolan. He then drew up what was left of his exhausted command. The recriminations began almost instantly.
Raglan argued that his order was perfectly understandable in the light of what had happened that morning. Lucan had been on the plane since 5 o'clock in the morning. Lucan, as the cavalry commander, therefore knew everything that had gone on that morning. And his argument, and indeed his criticism of Lucan, was that he did not interpret the order in the light of what had happened on the plane that morning. In Raglan's mind, there was no question that the guns to be taken were the guns that were in the redoubts. And therefore Lucan should have known that. Lucan took the view that what was written down was what he had to do.
If Raglan's order had been clearer, if Lucan had communicated better with Cardigan, or even if Cardigan had simply displayed some initiative rather than charging straight at the guns, then certainly things could have worked out better.
Raglan did not give a clear order. Raglan did not have a good enough eye for terrain to understand that Cardigan didn't have a clear picture of the battlefield. Raglan, who had never commanded troops in the field before and who had no training, issued an unclear order to Cardigan, who had never commanded troops in the field before and who had no training. The people caught in between, Lord Lucan, who had some combat experience, and Captain Nolan, who had some combat experience, the people who transmitted the order from Raglan to Cardigan, were not in a position to help the other leaders out because they didn't have enough of the picture.
The charge of the Light Brigade lasted approximately 25 minutes and covered a distance of a mile and a quarter. 673 men started out on the doomed journey towards the guns, the finest brigade of light cavalry Britain could muster, and all desperate to see action. When it was over, the brigade could boast only 195 fully fit men. 118 men were unaccounted for, and 247 more were walking wounded, unable to bear arms. 475 horses had been killed, with a further 42 injured. The Light Brigade had paid a terrible price for its ride to glory.
At the end of the battle, the Russian tactical commander, General Liprandi, interviewed one or two British prisoners and he suggested they'd done a very brave thing, but he was convinced they were drunk. He was horrified when he realized they were sober. The Russians could not understand how men could carry out such an operation stone cold sober.
Cardigan was a hero because he carried out what he'd done bravely, without a doubt. Lucan was this person who had misconceived what the order meant, and Raglan therefore blamed him in the long run.
A day that had started so well for the British had ended in disaster. The Russians had all but destroyed the Light Brigade. They had captured the guns from the redoubts. They still held part of the Causeway Heights. The British were left to reflect on a series of missed opportunities and misunderstandings.
In any direct sense, there are very few lessons to be drawn from what happened at Balaclava, because everyone knew the charge of the Light Brigade was a horrific mistake. And the lessons from that were self-evident.
Britain had to throw off the idea that just because Dad was an Earl, therefore you were an effective combat leader. And the Crimean War, and Balaclava in particular, helped prove to the British people and the British leaders that that was no way to run an army.
Cannon to the right of them, cannon to the left of them, cannon in front of them, volleyed and thundered, stormed at with shot and shell, boldly they rode, and well, into the jaws of death, into the mouth of hell, rode the 600.